Yeah.
या सो आई होप यू ऑल कैन हियर मी माइंड
सर आपका वीडियो चालू नहीं हुआ है बस.
ओके सॉरी या या आई होप यू ऑल कैन सी मी आल्सो आई एम नॉट श्योर वेट जस्ट
वी कैन
या सो आई होप यू कैन सी मी सो वी विल स्टार्ट विद द सेशन. बेसिक आइडिया इज टेस्ट टेकिंग स्ट्रेटजी इज व्हाट द फोकस इज फॉर टुडे. So let's look at what will come. So just generally first, how to prepare for each section. That's what we'll start with. Next, we'll go with a second stage of preparation. Let's say your syllabus complete, then what you need to do. That's the second thing that we'll cover. Third is a test taking strategy. That was the topic of today's session. So we'll look at what are the strategies that can be followed in each section. And last is what is really required to prepare the CAT. So four broad areas with regards to CAT examination. So let's start with each section. So this is based on last year's paper pattern to us. So since as of now, we have not yet got the exact paper pattern, and last year also didn't announce the paper pattern till the actual examination day, except that it was a 40-minute section. So let's assume that this is what is when we talk about the presentation. It can change. I'm not saying it cannot change. That is unpredictable, as Rishabh pointed out. But yes, for benefit of our session, let's assume that this is what's going to be. PRC 40 minutes, 26 questions. DLR 40 minutes, 24 questions. And mathematics 40 minutes, 26 questions. Yeah. So I'll come across with the significance of this maybe when we talk about how to take a strategy. But let's look at how to prepare. Now, if you look at VRC, 26 questions, 18 questions, RC, 3 questions, paralegals, 2 odd man out, and 3 paralegals. Sort of this way. So if you look at most of the questions, let's say there's 21 questions are directly based on reading and nothing else. I mean, if you just read, okay, I think this should take care of it. So these 21 questions which are there are directly based on reading. Okay. Even these 5 questions somewhere reading helps. So when you're looking at, arranging things, etc., reading definitely helps. There is, if you look at the whole paper as such, there is no grammar, there is no vocabulary at all. So if you're focusing on CAT, okay, purely CAT, then it's very, very clear that if I read regularly, it should take care of the examination. Nothing is required as far as VRC is concerned. So that is the most important part. How to read is what is important. But when I'm talking about reading, a lot of people have a wrong notion of reading ki, I have to read very difficult articles. Or I have to read fast. No, reading is just reading. You need to be comfortable with reading. That's what is important. Reading is nothing else. You need to understand what the author is trying to say, full stop. So it doesn't involve that I need to understand great vocabulary or great grammar, or I need to read difficult things to, you know, get the whole reading stuff done. No, try to enjoy your reading. The more you enjoy reading, the better you will be at VRC. The more you force yourself into reading, your VRC will suffer. Because the moment you force yourself, what happens is the ability to understand what the author is saying or to emotionally connect to what the author is saying loses out. So in that case, the most important part as far as reading is concerned is you need to enjoy it. And in order to enjoy reading, you need to read what you like reading. Let's be very clear with that. Right. So focus on reading, and that is the most important part. No questions on grammar, no questions on vocabulary. Yes, if you're looking for other exams, you can catch up on grammar, you can catch up on vocabulary. But even in other exams, if you look at ZAT and there are no major questions, and there's hardly one question on grammar, one question on vocabulary. Yes, some speed-based exams do have more of grammar vocabulary, but even there, if you read, it does help. Okay. So that's what makes a difference. So how do you prepare? So what I have noticed personally is that in the last 3 months, and particularly last year, the more you read, the higher you score in VRC. Okay, there's no two ways about it. So I've been noticing this from whatever years I'm writing the CAT. I see that whenever I read a lot just before the exam, the last 3 months, I tend to score higher in VRC. And when I don't read, I don't score much. I don't do anything else. I don't prepare for VRC. I teach quant, I teach DILR. So there's nothing of ERC I do. No RCs, no grammar, no vocabulary, nothing. Okay. And I don't read anything. I just read for my enjoyment. But what I've realized that the more I read in the last 3 months before the exam, the higher I score, the less I read, the lesser I score. That's a very clear case. And not that I'm very good at work. There have been cases in the past when I was writing the CAT for first time where I scored miserably in work. Okay, but it's all about reading. So just to give you an idea, I scored 99.90% in the verbal section in CAT 15 and 99.96% in CAT 16. And that is without any practice of RCs. Or I'm not saying don't practice RCs, or I'm not saying anything. I don't even write mocks. What I'm just saying is trying to reinforce the fact that reading becomes most important. And what did I read during these years? I've been reading like Harry Potter series. I've been reading a lot of rings, something that I enjoy reading. Nothing like very specific that make CAT ke liye padhna hai, uske liye padh raha hu. I never prepare for CAT as such. So I've been reading something which I enjoy reading, and that is what helps. So that's why I recommend students. So when you read, read something that you enjoy. Okay. So technically, if I say what your preparation should be for CAT in terms of ERC, so let me say if I'm reading for, let's say, 1.5 hours, I'll maybe at least spend 1 hour reading something what I like or enjoy, and maybe 15, 20 minutes or 20 to 30 minutes on maybe some articles of newspapers or something on that, or some articles from some source. But most of the time I spend on reading what I like. I need to enjoy my reading. It should give me my space. It should be something which I do. Sometimes I get flow with reading and I read the whole day. That is a different question. But yes, read what you do. That's more important. Okay. Also, now since there is Parajumble, the ordinary now do practice these questions. I mean, there are 5 questions of, and there's a good weightage on it. I mean, Parajumbles, whether you solve or not solve, do practice. It may help you in ordinary now. So these are the only things that is there in the verbal section, not much. So you can practice RCs or read, and you can practice Parajumbles in ordinary. Avoid grammar, okay? Because I don't think grammar is at all important as for that. For other exams also, my suggestion is don't look at grammar books. English grammar is too confusing. I mean, you go through the books, no matter how much you study, you will end up scoring, getting confused. So avoid grammar as far as possible. If you want to practice grammar for other exams, pick up exercise books, solve the exercises, and wherever you go wrong, note it down in a book and try to correct from there. Okay, that's what. Vocabulary, I mean, you can do word list, can do word power made easy, specifically for students who are vernacular medium. Yes, you can do vocabulary. It is, could be important. It's not required for people who are comfortable with the English language, but for, yes, people from vernacular medium, maybe vocabulary could be important, could help. I had a student, I remember very clearly, was from vernacular medium, and he used to do, you know, vocabulary regularly. He got called from IIM Ahmedabad scoring a 99.8%, different matter. But yes, you can do vocabulary. But I've seen a lot of vernacular medium students cracking the CAT and doing extremely well. So it will not affect your overall score in VRC. But if you want to do, you can do the work. But as I said, preparation should be purely based on reading and nothing else. Now, coming to in this itself, while preparing, coming to reading comprehension. Now, there are 2 schools of thought. I've talked to people, faculty of VRC from various places, just to find out what works in VRC. Because when I guide students, I have to guide in all areas. So normally they say definitely reading is more important. And they also say that reading comprehension should be solved regularly. I have a very different opinion. My personal opinion is that reading comprehension solving too much does not help. That's my coming across to RC, this is my personal opinion. Again, I'm saying that I talk to a lot of people and they say practicing RC is important. I personally feel practicing RC is not very important because most of the RCs that see that are available around focus more on kind of solve questions. I mean, if I look at the way the RCs are there around, when you read, your focus is on solving questions rather than understanding the passage. So back of my mind, I think, oh, yeh question hoga, let me focus on the details and try to get the answer. But CAT RCs are not that way. CAT RCs are very different from what you see your normal RCs. In a CAT RC, if you want to really get the answer, you should be able to understand the passage. That means your reading ability is checked and not your ability to remember things. So if I go fast, I understand what is being said without getting into too much of details, I still will be able to answer the question in the RCs, in the CAT RC, which may not be true in the other type of RCs. Okay, just saying. But yes, do practice a few RCs here and there. That should definitely help. And but yes, focus definitely is reading. Read a lot as far as possible. If you feel you're weak in verbal, read. It is a slow process. I'm not saying it will come fast. It's a slow process, but you have ample time right now. So do read and try to improve your skills as far as verbal is concerned. Coming next to DILR. Okay, you have, at least in the last year, you had 24 questions, two sets of 6 questions each and 3 sets of 4 questions each. Okay. What does DILR section check you on? I'll come on the strategy later on, but let's focus on what does it check you on. It checks you on a thinking ability. If you look at the type of question that come in the exam, the DILR section, they are more logic-based questions. I mean, they make you think. Even a DILR set question make you think. They're there to make you think, most of them. Okay. So DILR out there is to make you think, and therefore the questions that come in the examination are normally different from what you see around. They're normally all new questions where you must have not seen the question before. You must have seen sort of a similar question before, but not the same question as such, or not the same way of solving. So that means if I want to solve a set in the examination, I have to end up thinking. So thinking process becomes very, very important for DILR. So if I'm able to think properly, I should be able to do well in DILR. Okay. Calculation is important. I'm not saying calculation is not important, but in CAT, you also have a calculator. So in that case, you can use a calculator, though I normally tend to tell people not to use calculator, but you can use a calculator if there are tough calculations. Most of the time, the calculations that are normally there in the exam are simple calculations, but only if you are, there are tough calculations, like 3-digit, 4-digit multiplications, then you can use a calci. Else, try to be good at calculations. We'll come back to it later. All right. But the focus is to try to improve on your thinking ability. The more you improve on your thinking ability, the better you'll be able to solve your DILR, which also means that trying to solve varied type of questions as far as possible. Okay, coming to DILR, if you look at a question, normally are mix of logic and DILR. Either they are pure logic or they are mix of logic and DILR. But in the exam, the more is the focus on logic. My recommendation, don't give any specific section for option. I mean, don't give logic for option or don't give DILR for option. For example, I don't remember which year in CAT 15 it was, where people had gone for the examination and people had kept logic for options, because what used to happen was there were equal number of sets of logic and DILR that used to come in the exam. So 8 sets, so 4 sets of logic, 4 sets of DILR. Logic I find difficult, so they said, I'll not look at logic at all. I'll focus on DILR, solve a couple of sets, get decent percentile, clear the cutoffs. Okay. But when they went for the exam, all the 8 sets were logic based. All the 8 sets. So those who focused more on DILR section, they found it really difficult. Yeah, getting some problem. Yeah, so let's continue. As I said, don't keep any specific areas for. Logic is one of the areas which can definitely improve with practice. Okay, if I look at mathematics, the syllabus is vast, so it takes a longer time to cover the entire syllabus. Verbal is slightly a slow process of improvement. Logic is one area where if you keep practicing, you tend to improve. No two ways about it. You need to keep practicing. I mean, normally I relate logic with chess sort of thing. Okay, in chess, it is said that any average person can become a grandmaster in 5 years if you give enough time to it. That means if you practice enough. It's more a pattern formation in your mind. The more you practice, the more you form patterns in your mind, and the better you'll be able to solve. Same with regards to, logic. The more you practice, the better you'll be able to form pattern as to how to solve, how not to solve, and the better you will be. So you will require to practice in order to improve. But yes, what I've seen in logic is definitely improved with a lot of practice. So keep practicing. Normally, mocks are a good source. The current mocks or the last 1-2 years mocks is what you can look at. It's a good source for practice. I mean, normally what happens is those are the questions that are made from, inspired by the CAT paper, and they're good source. So if you want to really practice DILR questions, I normally advise not to go to the books, because books, the questions are not very great. There are a lot of mocks available freely online. You can check out the mocks, past year mocks. Specifically, my preference is for IMS or CL. If you can look at these mocks, past or current year, you can pick up that and try to solve the questions from there. Okay. Apart from that, solve puzzles. Puzzles like Sudoku, etc. Okay, it helps you improve your thinking ability. So I've seen people who have regularly solved puzzles, Sudoku, Kakuro, Hirato, definitely help your thinking process, definitely help to improve in DILR. So this is what with regards to DILR, generally in terms of what to prepare. Coming to mathematics, 26 question, mixture of different topics. Again, a lot of people do a mistake saying that maths is pure mathematics in the examination. Maths is not pure mathematics. If you look at a lot of questions in the examination cannot be solved by direct formula or direct tricks. It makes you think. Okay. If it was able to solve direct formula, people would have solved it fast. I mean, put a formula, get the answer. But it is not a formula-based paper. It is, again, a logic-based paper. The idea of examination is to make you think. Even the mathematics section, if you look at, is not a direct. They don't want to check how great mathematician you are. That is not the idea of the exam. The idea of the exam is just to see how good is your thinking ability under stress. And that is what it takes to on. Therefore, the questions are normally very different from what you've solved. You must have not seen the same question before. And therefore, you have to think on the spot and try to get the answer. Yes, simple tricks and techniques to get the answer. But yes, try to look at ways and means of how to solve. Focus on alternate methods more than that, because it makes you think. Therefore, whenever you solve a question, go back and see, can I get a better way of solving it? Is there an alternate way of solving it? Is that should hopefully help you in terms of improvement in terms of mathematics. Trying to get, don't get too many methods. I mean, I know that everyone has a different method to solve, but see what methods you are comfortable with and try to follow those methods. So maybe for every sum, if you can get even maybe one more method, that could suffice just to help you think differently. It should make you think. That is what's important. So what normally students do is when they solve mathematics, they focus more on a mathematical formula. So I get a question, I get a formula, I get the answer. School level mathematics type. But that doesn't help me, or that will not help you in the exam. So what you need to focus on is there a better way of solving? Don't look at formulas, but a better way. Can I use the options? Can I substitute the values? Can I do something else so that I can get a better, can I solve faster? So that is what your focus should be as far as the exam is concerned. So if you can do that, that should hopefully help you with regards to getting good at mathematics. You obviously should know the basic formulas, simple like profit and loss, ka formulas, everything that basic school level mathematics should be known. Beyond that, you don't require any formulas. You just have to try to think and try to get the answer. Open skill. Okay, let's take. I'm not saying this is a come that's coming cat. So let's look at how to solve. So solve this and try to put in the chat box the answer. Cat 20 below. So if you want to just solve it. Okay. So if you look at normal weight in kgs, okay, normal formula of weight is equal to if you look at prepare mixing alloy. They're given the volume and they're given weights of same volume. So weight is nothing but weight per unit volume into volume will give you weight. Okay, weight per unit volume into volume will give you weight. Weights per unit volume is given to you 5:2:6. If I look at weight per unit volume is given as 5:2:6 for A, B, and C. And volume is given as 3:4:7. So automatically, if I look at it, my weight as a ratio should be multiplication of this, which is 5 3s are 15, 4 2s are 8, 7 6s are 42. So which means if I add all this, this becomes 65. 65 stands for 130 kgs. Double. So it means C will be double, which is 84 kgs. First option. So you got the answer. Then there are other concepts that are there. For example, I can always look at multiples. Multiples are good ways of trying to get answers quickly. For example, normally if the volume of C is 7, technically the weight should be a multiple of 7. If the volume of C is 7, normally in the multiples we look at prime numbers. Prime number 7 is there. So technically the weight overall should be a multiple of 7. All the values are integers anyway. So if I look at the option, answer should technically be 84 or 70. Similarly, if I look at weight for the same volume is 6, that is density sort of. 6 multiple of 3, let's say. I'm taking prime numbers. So since the weight per unit volume is a multiple of 3, therefore, obviously, the overall weight should be also multiple of 3. There, I can eliminate 70 and I can get the answer as 84. So what I'm working on, I'm looking on a concept called multiple of prime numbers. So now if I use the same concept in multiple sums, I'll be comfortable with it. I mean, doing in one sum is no use. You need to be able to use it in number of sums and be comfortable with it. Maybe in the exam, I'll go back to the old method and say that that method is good, I'll use that. But I have an alternate method, which means if one method doesn't work, I can always go back to a second method and try to look at it. And that's how I solve in the exam. So I try one method, okay, doesn't work. Let me try second method, doesn't work. Let me try third method. Some method will work and I'll get the answer. But not too many methods, because if you try too many methods, what happens is then your comfort level with each method goes down. When you use a method, you should be able to use it in multiple sums. So then will you be able to be comfortable with that method? So one method which I looked at is a multiple. Or if say total is 42, its answer should be multiple of 42. Or it should be multiple of 7 or multiple of 3. So here normally we use prime number multiple to try to get the answer. That becomes quicker in terms of getting the answer. Okay, coming to second part of our presentation, this second stage of preparation. Let's say your syllabus is over, what you need to do next. Okay, there are three things that you need to do. One, three things that normally students do. One is revision, that is going back to topics, okay, and then trying to practice some questions, revising the concept and practicing the questions. Second is mocks without time limit. That means trying to go to the mocks, picking up questions and practicing. I mean, I normally don't recommend practicing from the books. I'll give you a reason for it. I normally prefer practicing from the mock papers. Though they are difficult and some of the questions are horrible, that never come in the CAT exam, but still there are some decent questions which are there where you can practice and try to solve. So solving mixed questions from current or past mocks. Again, the focus should be ideally to get better methods as far as possible. And last, mocks with time limit. Normal mocks take a 2-hour time limit and try to focus. So when you solve mocks with time limit, the focus is strategy. Okay, you experiment, try to find out what works for you, what doesn't work for you. Try one strategy, try a second strategy, and keep experimenting and see what works for you. That's a mocks with time limit. So there are three things which are there which you should do. Normally, what I would recommend is start with these two. I mean, I'm normally not for revision going back to topics. Start with these two, mocks without time limit, mocks with time limit. When you solve this, you will realize first what questions are important, because normally the question that comes in the mocks are based on the importance that come in the exam, their recent trends. So if you feel that logs are more in the mocks, that means logs are important. If you see no questions on remainder theorem in the mocks, that means there will be no questions on remainder theorem is not important. I'm just giving an example. Mocks will try to follow what is there in the examination. But most of the mocks, there are some mocks which are horrible, but I'm not getting into it. But yes, most of the mocks do follow the trend that normally comes in the exam. So from that, you will come to know which topics are important. Then you will come to know, okay, these are the topics I'm not comfortable with. Regularly I'm doing wrong or regularly I'm not able to understand on these topics, right? Go to revision and solve it. Go to revise, go to the topics from the books and practice. Don't get disheartened by saying that I don't know any question. That's fine. I mean, remember in the actual examination, you will have to leave more questions than maybe solve it. That is what we'll have to do in the actual exam for everyone almost. So in that case, don't worry about it. I don't know a lot of questions. In the actual exam also, there is a high chance that you may not know most of the questions. The key is trying to solve whatever possible and trying to get the right method to solve and trying to able to find out which questions are easy and which questions are difficult. Okay, why do I prefer practicing from the mocks rather than the books? Okay, few reasons. One is because in the books, normally the questions which are there are more concept driven. They are mainly there for clearing your concept. But in the mocks, the questions are more application based, the way it comes in the examination. So I normally prefer to solve from the mocks. Okay. Second, the weightage of topics in mocks will be as per the examination. So that means if I practice from the mocks, I will end up practicing more questions whose weightage is higher and less questions whose weightage is lower. Okay, in the books, I will then focus on topics which may not be important. For example, if I spend days on days on remainder theorem and Bayes' theory, which never comes in the exam, it'll be a waste of time. Right? Third, in the examination, if you look at it, the question that normally comes are mix-ups. So that means when I think, I should be able to think from one question to the next question. My thinking process should be able to change. But if I solve questions from the same topic, I'm using the same concepts on every question. My thinking process is not changing from one question to second question. That feel of the exam question doesn't come in. So normally I prefer solving from the mixed questions, either from the mocks or whatever your sources, mixed questions as far as possible, mocks or sections, etc. If you find difficulty, go with the revision. Okay, it should be that way. Solve the mocks, practice mocks without time limit, and then whatever you find difficult, then go to revision. Now, why do I also say without time limit and with time limit? With time limit, the focus is strategy. I need to experiment, see what works strategy, what strategy doesn't work. Without time limit, the focus should be methods. Because when I solve with time limit, what happened? Because of a time limit, I'm not able to think good methods. I will do whatever first comes to my mind. I'll put a formula and try to get the answer. But when I do without time limit, I have time. Take some time, say 15 seconds per max question or maybe whatever time, and try to think, is there a better way of solving this question before you actually put a pen and solve? Okay. So this is what I recommend. So net, your practice in the second stage of preparation will be based on these three. Revision, mocks without time limit, mocks with time limit for all the three areas, more or less. So the breakup could differ. So if I feel I'm not getting very high marks in mocks, I'll spend more time on revision. If I feel I'm getting okay marks in mocks, maybe I'll spend more time in mocks without time. Okay, that's how. So you break up your time based on what your comfort level is. If you're not, but again, your practice should be based on what is the weightage of the topics. And accordingly, you can decide on the practice section. Okay, coming to September, I mean, August is almost gone. So I'm talking of September. What could be done? Mocks with analysis, that is with time limit. You can give two or three mocks a week. I'm not a person who says I mocks every day. I'm not normally for it. I'm okay with even writing one mock a week. That's fine, as long as you do proper analysis. Unfortunately, students don't do proper analysis. So if you write a mock of 2 hours, you may have to actually analyze it for almost 4 to 5 hours minimum. That's how the analysis should be. Very deep analysis. Every question you should analyze, find out what is wrong, what is the. So that means in September, at least 2 or 3 mocks per week is what I would recommend to solve. Mocks without time limit, you can solve further 2 mocks a week without time limit. Practice, pick up questions from mock and just practice maybe 2 or 3 more mocks, depending on the time that you have. And then revision, maybe twice or thrice a week. So maybe twice a week, you'll keep separate time for revision where you say, okay, these are the topics I'm not comfortable with. Let me focus on revising those topics. Okay, and accordingly, revise your topics, go back to books, practice, revise, and then solve. This is how you can solve. Ideally, you should have maybe someone to discuss your questions and, you know, practice with. So if you have a study partner, it will always help. Maybe have, try to find a study partner. We'll talk about it further again later on as to why a study partner is important. But yes, if you can have a study partner, that normally definitely helps in your practice. Okay, let's take one more question. Okay, try solving this and yes, try to put the answer in the chat box. Yeah, you can. Yes, simple way of trying to use a formula and try to get the answer, not denying it. So let me look at a formula itself and then look at a other way. So if you look at 10,000 simple interest and exactly after 2 years, Joy invested 8,000. So he invested 10,000. Okay, add 5% simple interest, right? And he invested for, let's say, X years. So the interest he gets is so much. So the amount will be this plus 10,000. This should be equal to, you know, interest that you get from second, 8,000 into 10% into X minus 2 years upon 100 plus 8,000. I can do this definitely. But if I can do this without writing itself, that will be great. I'll write it down to explain it to you. But there are ways to do it without writing. And if you can do some without writing, it will be really, really fast. Let's take an example of it. So in the first case, we do, for the interest rate you get every year, 10,000 into 5%, which is 500 rupees. In case of Joy, what's the interest rate you get every year? 8,000 into 10%, 800 rupees. So Viru started with 10,000. In 2 years, it will become 11,000. In 2 years, Viru will become 11,000. Joy starts with 8,000 after 2 years. So difference in the amount is 3,000. Difference in the amount that they have is 3,000. Because after 2 years, Viru has 11,000, Joy has 8,000. Now Viru gets 500 every year. Joy gets 800 every year, which is 300 more. So if you get 300 more every year, you get 3,000 how many years? So 3,000 upon 300, 10 years. 10 years plus the initial 2 years, because we want from where Viru started investment. So 12 years, that'll be the answer. So if you're decent at simple calculations, then this can be done. So in 2 years, Viru will get 1,000 extra, so 11,000. 11,000, 8,000 difference is 3,000, but difference in the interest that I get is 300. So to get 3,000 rupees, they will take 10 years, 300 every year. So to get 3,000, they'll take 10 years, plus the 2 years in the start will give you 12 years. So 12 is the answer. That's how you solve. So try every sum if possible. If you're comfortable with mathematics, just look at it and see if there are alternate ways of solving apart from the formulas that could help. Okay, now we go to test taking strategy. And basically strategy in terms of how to go about solving a test. So I'm just keeping a benchmark right now of 90 percentile just to explain maybe the strategy for a 90 percentile. You can maybe create any benchmark for yourself and then accordingly look at the scores required and work on. I'm basing it on CAT 20, but it can change. The difficulty level of paper will change. So you have to be very flexible with your strategy, because we don't know how the paper is going to be this year. So paper could be very different. So therefore your strategy should be very flexible in terms of solving this up. So let's start with VRC. VRC, 26 questions are a total question that are there in the exam. And in 27 marks, you will get your 90%. Last year, 27 marks, you use 90%. So even if you solve 9 out of 26 questions and get them correct, you'll still get a 90%. I'm just giving an example. If I solve 9 questions out of 26 and ensure that all are correct, I'll still get up. But unfortunately, in VRC, getting all correct is really difficult. Or I don't know if anyone gets solved correct. And we're coming to DILR, 24 questions. Even if I get 20 marks, I'll still get 90%, which is around 7 questions correct. So around 2 sets correct. Let's see. I should get out of the 5 sets which are there, I need to get 2 sets to my correct. Same in mathematics, 26 questions, 22 marks is what I require, just 7 to 8 questions correct approximately. So this is for 90. You need to base on whatever your target is accordingly change. Don't give a very high target from what you're scoring. Your targets has to jump in very small numbers. If you're scoring maybe a 40 percentile, keep a 50-60 percentile target. 60, then keep a 70 percentile target or 80. Just have small jumps. If from a very small number, if you try to jump to a very high number, you will falter. It will not happen. Okay, because then the strategy will differ. You have to evolve over a period of time. I remember I had a student who had scored maybe less than 70 percentile initially. He slowly went to 75, 80 percentile, target 80, went to 85 to 90 then. Then he went to 92 percentile. And he had a different strategy. He ended up working on 99.8 percentile in the exam. But yes, the scores increased gradually. It doesn't have to increase jumping. It cannot, doesn't happen. The jump happens only in the actual exam. Suddenly the paper comes nice and you're relaxed and you click, then the score suddenly jump in the actual exam. In mocks, it may not happen. But anyway, coming here, this is what. If you notice out here, you will tend to leave more questions than solve. So out of 26 questions, so 90%. I have only solved 9 questions. For 24, 7, 26, 8, I will end up leaving more questions than I solve. Even for a 99 percentile, okay, out of 228, I have to get 100 marks approximately. for 99%, which is less than half. Okay. So I'm just saying that you will tend to solve less number of questions than maybe so then you leave. You may end up leaving more questions than solve, even if you're aiming maybe at 99%. So that means it's very important. Understand this, specifically in a 2-hour paper, more than a 3-hour paper. In a 2-hour paper, it is extremely important to be able to identify difficult level of questions quickly and leave them. If you can do that, you will be able to do well. Okay, so let's come to the strategy. Let's say VRs. So I'll just mention a couple of strategies, but you have to experiment and see what works for you, what doesn't work for you. Start with maybe going fast and trying to solve all questions. Start with maybe then going slow. Experiment, and that's what you will know how it works. So one is in VRC, speed versus accuracy becomes very important. Right. So one strategy, maybe I go fast speed. I solve 24 questions, get 12 wrong, 50% accuracy. I may still end up getting a 90% right. Right. So 12 wrong, maybe I'll still get 27 marks. 12 wrong is 36 marks minus whatever marks, 9 maybe for wrong questions, because there are theta questions also. So I may end up still getting a 27 marks and get a 90% right. Or maybe I focus on accuracy. So maybe solve 12 questions only and get only 2 wrong. Focus on accuracy and get it. So that you have to experiment to see what works, what doesn't work. Okay. So maybe a couple of papers solve very fast, solve all questions and see how it works. What is the accuracy? In other papers, try to go slow and see if you can go accurate. Then you will come to know in which part of the paper, if I solve fast, it is good for me. Which part of the paper, if I go slow, it is good for me. That you have to analyze. It's all analysis. The more you analyze, the better you will understand everything. One more parameter to understand how to solve is your marks per minute. Okay, checks per mark so in each area and see, okay, what to prioritize. Right. So every area, for example, in RC, how much marks do you get per minute? So check out your marks that you get in your mock, check out the time that you spend, and find out the marks per minute in the section. Same if for parajumbles, same if for odd man out, same if for parasum. Try to find marks per minute for each area. From there, you will know which to solve, which to leave, where you get more marks per minute, where you get less marks per minute. A lot of students solve parajumbles because it's theta, but they don't understand that they spend a lot of time on it. All right? So you end up 10 minutes and you don't get anything right, doesn't make sense at all. You wasted your 10 minutes. So that means identify what to solve. What I'm not saying don't solve parallels, but the key of trying to identify what to solve or what not to solve is based on marks per minute. Find out marks per minute what you get in parajumbles. Find out marks per minute what you get in different areas, the odd man out, para summary, RC, etc., and see where you get higher and where you get low. Based on that, then you decide which you should solve first, which you should solve second, and so on. So two ways: one is speed versus accuracy. Second is marks per minute. Check out, find out what works, what doesn't work. There are many, many other ways of experimenting. Keep experimenting and see what works and what doesn't. DL, 24 questions, as you said, 20 marks is what is required, 7 questions is correct. In this case, selection of sets are very important. I mean, if I select a wrong set, okay, then it may just hamper my whole paper. And if I select the right set, it can go well. But invariably, let me tell you, there is a high chance that in the entire paper, you will select a wrong, and everyone, it's not for one person, so everyone. But problem is, how do you come out of that wrong selection? A lot of students get panic and paranoid when they select a wrong question. Oh, my 10 minutes are gone. What should I do? Don't do that. Learn to relax and try to solve. Don't get paranoid and, you know, hassled when you select wrong. The more relaxed you in the exam, the better you will be able to solve. Okay. My normal recommendation is try to spend around 1.5 to 2 minutes per set to select. I mean, if you're further good, maybe you can take 1 minute, but normally 1.5 to 2 minutes per set to select. Don't leave a set by just looking at it, ye dikh raha hai, tough hai, leave it. Avoid, just read through it a little bit, because the time that you spend on selection is an investment on the question. Once you're comfortable, then you can decide how to select, what not to select, but it is initially spend that much time on selection. Not more than this also, because if you spend too much time on selection, you'll waste a lot of time. Okay, strategy. One strategy recommendation, there are 5 sets. So spend 8 minutes, go through all the 5 sets. Okay. And in next 32 minutes, try three sets, around 11 minutes per set. You may not get one, you may get two correct. And that will help you to get 90%. Just so one strategy could be 8 minutes, go to all the five sets which are there, maybe around 1.5-2 minutes per set. So you have at least have idea of each set which is there. Pick up three sets. You may not, there could be a wrong selection also. Pick up three sets. From that, maybe one set you may not get, but if you get two sets, you will get your 90%. Right? It is important not to waste too much time on a set. So if you're not getting a set, leave it. Okay, that's what is important. Because if you spend too much time on a set and in the end, if you don't get the answer, that can create a lot of pressure. Also, what is important is not to panic if we waste time. Okay, don't panic. And it is easy to panic, but I've seen in DILR, people normally get one set in the last 7-8 minutes. If you're relaxed, it happens. But what is important is to relax. I remember, okay, also one more thing is avoid keeping target. Okay. I mean, that also creates a lot of pressure in DILR. Oh, I have to solve two sets. Oh, my 25 minutes, okay, and I'm not able to solve a single set. And that creates more panic and you're not able to solve a single set. But normally what I've seen is even if you're not able to solve 25 minutes, even a single set, there are people who solve two sets in the last 15 minutes. Certainly things click, you get the answer and you're able to solve it. But for clicking, you need to relax. If you panic, you will be out. Now, why do I say not to keep targets? Or not to try to solve all the questions? I remember in one of the CATs when I had gone for the CAT exam, I said, I will solve all the questions in the exam. All the whatever 8 sets were there. Because I was confident, I normally get 100% well in DILR, let me solve all 8 sets. The first set I looked at it, and I had to solve all sets, right? So I cannot leave any sets. I spent 10, 12 minutes on it and didn't get the answer. So my 12 minutes have gone in the exam. I have not solved a single question. I have not got a single answer. And I'm there and I want to solve all 8 sets. And I was laughing at myself, like, how will I be able to solve 8 sets in a given time limit? Not possible. So then I said, forget it. No targets. Chitna aata utna karunga. If it's easy, I'll solve. If it's tough, I'll leave. And I went with more relaxed mind. And after that, I was able to solve the sets. Because I'm more relaxed. I was able to solve maybe 5-6 sets, etc. I was able to even come back and solve the first set. So now I was more relaxed. I was able to even think through that set. So having more relaxed mind in DILR is very important to be able to solve. Psychology plays a very, very important role, specifically in DILR section, because there not getting a set could create a problem. So the more relaxed you are, the more carefree you are, the better you will be able to solve in a DILR section. But it's more of psychology in DILR. And I'm talking to students nowadays and I see them, they come back to me and tell, I'm able to solve the sets after the exam, but during the mocks, I'm not able to solve. Stress. Learn to relax. DILR, a lot of things place because less time limit. Look, in a 1 hour test, it was okay. You could come back to a 5-10 minutes, I panic, and then I come back, it's okay. You could do that in a 1 hour test. In a 40 minute test, I can't waste 10 minutes in panicking. I have to be relaxed and try to solve. Gone 26 questions. So I said around 22 marks. So 7 to 8 questions you can say correct for getting a 90% test. Ideally, maybe 10 questions. I may go wrong in 2 questions, 8 correct. I'll get a 90% test. 10 questions attempt, 8 correct should get me a 90% test technically. Strategies. So let me look at the various strategies I can solve. So one strategy, maybe I can go through all questions. Okay, in the first round, go to all the questions and solve 5 to 6 easy questions. So in 25 minutes, I solve only 5 or 6 questions, not more than that. But I've gone through all the questions. Okay, and whatever I've not solved, I mark them as medium or tough. Okay, I mean, should I come back to second round or should I not come back to second? That's all. So after 25 minutes, I still have 15 minutes left. I come back and look at the medium level questions which I marked and solve 4 to 5 questions from one strategy. So first round. So it's important to leave questions. So what problem is people don't leave questions. For example, let me take quant itself. There are 26 questions. If I take, say, 1 minute to leave per question, I'm just giving an example, 1 minute per question. We try to understand, oh, it's tough, easy, chorunga. My 26 minutes is gone out of 40 minutes. I don't have time. If I spend half a minute per question, I still waste 13 minutes on selection of question. Can't. So your leaving of questions has to be in 15 seconds. Okay, in a con section, when you leave a question which is difficult, you should be leaving in 15 seconds. Just read, important to read. Read a question and then decide, okay, tough way, let me leave it. That's how you do. So it's, you cannot try to solve and leave it. You don't have a time. A difficult question, you have to leave it without solving. The moment you start solving, you wasted 1 minute already. Remember that. Okay, you should try to leave questions without solving. Another strategy could be that go to 9 questions. I'm breaking this 26 question into 3 parts, 9, 9, and 8. So go to 9 questions in every 10 minutes. Solve maybe 2 or 3 questions in every 9 questions. Okay, 2 or 3, which are easy questions. And remaining mark is medium or tough. So in 30 minutes, I've gone through all the questions. 10 minutes are left. In last 10 minutes, try to solve 2 or 3 more questions from the remaining questions. So go back to questions which you feel that are solvable and try to solve 2 or 3. Again, you'll end up solving 10 questions and maybe get 90%. So I'm just saying, formulate a strategy based on, you know, what marks. Again, in the actual exam, the whole thing would be very different. If a paper is easy, you'll have to solve more. If a paper is tough, you'll have to solve less. So your strategy has to be flexible. If you're getting answers quickly, that means the cutoff will go up. You should solve, try to solve more number of questions. If you're not getting the answer at all, that means the paper is tough. So you try to solve whatever is easy and go ahead. You need to be flexible with your strategy because CAT is unpredictable. You don't know how it will be in the actual exam. Right? Okay. So we take one more question. So fillers or whatever it is. So start with VMAX. So yeah, you can put the answer in the chat box. Going to this question, you can say, there's one very clear basic way of solving. Work done upon mandates equal to work done upon mandates. So initially, if you look at 1.5 kilometer was worked on by, let's say 60 days he worked and he took 140 people. Now he has to complete how much? 4.5 kilometers, because out of 6, 1.5 is over. 4.5 kilometers by, in 140 days into X number of people. So when you solve it, you should get X as 180. So you already have 140 people, so you require 40 more people. There's also a way to do orally. I'm just writing it down, but it's just orally to be done. So if you look at in 60 days, okay, I require 140 people to do the work. So if I want 140 days, but now I have 140 more days left, I'll require 60 people to do the work. Okay, in 60 days, I require 140 people to do the work. So if I want to complete the work in 140 days, because now it's 140 days, I'll require 60 people to do the work. Right, same work, if the work is same. But the work is 3 times, 1.5 to 6, well, 4.5 kilometer work is to be done. 3 times, so I'll require 3 times the number of people, which is 180 people. So I'll require 40 more. That is the answer. So first I assume one parameter to get the next parameter. So first I look only days and people. So 60 days, 140 people. So 140 days, 60 people. But the amount of work to be done is 3 times. So number of people required is 3 times. 180. So 40 more people. So 40 is the answer. So look, keep on looking out for ways to do things faster. Okay, let's take one more sum and then I'll last work on what is required to crack the CAT. What generally is required if you want to crack. Let's try to solve this first. Yeah, so basically there's a matter where you can assume maybe cost price 100 and then solve. Okay, I'll just cut everything and just come back to it. Cost price is same for everything. 4 are sold at loss of 25%. And 6 are sold at a profit of 25%. Right? Same cost price. So 4 loss will be cancelled with 4 profit. So what is left is 2 is left. 2 are sold at a profit of 25% on cost price. Okay, because 4 loss will be same as 4 profit because profit and loss percent is same. So what is left is 2 profit of cost price. That is equal to 2000. Or you can say 50% of cost price is 2000. So you can say cost price is equal to 4,000. That will be the answer, right? Because four data sold on loss will be same as four data sold on profit. If you cancel them, what is left is only two. Two are sold at profit of 25%, which is 2,000 given to you. Solve it and you'll get 4,000. Technically, you can solve it orally again. You don't have to write it down. You can solve it orally. Okay. Coming to what is required to crack the CAT exam. Okay, be regular. Very important. I mean, a lot of people don't crack the exam purely we are not ready. You can take breaks in between, a small breaks where you are, say, saturated and you feel named, or let me take a break of a day or two. That is fine. No harm in that. But as far as possible, be regular. So you may have a like planned break. So say in a 7 day a week, you may study for 6 days and one day you may take a break. That's perfectly all right. Okay, which is a planned break. But being regular is most important because most of the students are not ready. Because they start preparing and they get bored and they don't prepare at all for a long time and then it goes, then it doesn't come back. So being regular is most important part. Never give up. I'll give you an example. I can give you a number of examples. Just one example, maybe of last year's student. A person was scoring actually negative marks in the sections. Negative marks and finding it very difficult. So she had decided that she will take admission at itself. And though she had joined the class, she said, "Nay, I will take." She was trying to take admission to some college with no entrance examination. And any matter, it was not even worth mentioning the college. So that way. To any college which takes admission, she decided I'll take the admission. I don't want to write the entrance exam. But then we convinced her saying that you can always take the admission next year. At least give one attempt for the examination. So she said, okay, let me give one attempt. Though she was putting negative marks, she said, okay, let me give one attempt and just try. Although you can always get into the same college next year. So she started preparing. So initially, from negative, she came to single digit marks. She got 4 marks, 5 marks, etc. in one section, whatever. Slowly started improving. She said, okay, let me now plan. So she formed a group of friends. There were some 3 or 4 friends were there. So they should help each other around. And she got a help from there. She changed the strategy of how to solve. She said, let me not solve too many questions. Let me solve less number of questions. And let me get a 2-digit marks at least. Forget 99. Let me get 2-digit marks. So she started with that. She started with getting 2-digit marks, solving less number of questions and getting 2-digit marks. Once she reached that level, then she said, okay, let me see, can I solve it in a different way, methods of solving questions. So she went back to pond questions. She said, picked up a few easy questions and see, can I solve it by using options or by some simple methods. So for a few of the questions, she devised the methods and tried to get simple methods or simple questions correct. Okay, in the end, after a lot of things, by the time she came up, this was somewhere in August itself. August, she had tried to give up. From August, then in somewhere in November, she came up where she could get maybe a 70-80 percentile in a tough section. Okay. And then in the actual exam, she managed to score 80 percentile in the quant section. Quant was the tough section. Managed to score overall 95 percentile in the examination, overall examination. Okay. Scored 80 percentile in the quant section, scored a 95 percentile in the overall examination, and managed to get into MBA. Gurgaon, 95%. From getting into some college is unknown, maybe getting 95% plus and getting into a college like amazing. So don't give up. Even if you're getting less marks, no marks, give one try. Try, experiment, figure it out if it works, not works. Then you can always get into some college or some other option. But now since there is 3 months left, 3.5 months left, just give it one try where you can maybe try to see how you can solve work. That's what is important. Okay. Things that is important you should do. Read regularly. That's very important. Read what you like. I have no problem with that. Read a storybook. Read what you like. Read articles on sports if you like sports. So if you like cricket, maybe pick up books on cricket, autobiographies and read. Fine. So, but read. One of the most important part for the entire paper. It helps you in logic and maths also. We think reading only helps in verbal. No. More you read, the better you understand the language. And the better you'll be able to understand the logic section and the verbal section. So read regularly. That's very, very important as far as possible. Most important part of preparing for CAT is reading. So ensure that you're regular in reading. And let me tell you, most of the students are not regular in reading. Most of the students. Read what you like, but spend 15 to 20 minutes every day on reading some articles from varied sources. You can maybe go to aldaily.com. You'll get many articles from different sources. Pick up a few articles and so try that. Okay. One more important thing that could help is being good at simple calculations. I'm not talking Vedic mathematics. I'm not talking abacus. I'm saying simple two-digit calculations should be comfortable with. Okay. Try every day. Maybe spend some time on calculation that could help hopefully. Okay. Try to improve your calculation because a lot of students waste a lot of time on calculations. And for non-CAT exam, you don't have a calculator also. So you will have to calculate. But normally the calculations are not tough. They're easy. Like the way we did in previous question. So 25% for 2 years is 50%. And 2000 upon 50% is 4000. So if you can do this only, they're not difficult calculations. But simple calculations, if you can understand it, could help you a lot. Solve puzzles on a regular basis. Sudoku, Kakuro, makes you think. And thinking is what is tested in the CAT examination. The more you're able to think, the better you will be in the CAT. So if you can solve maybe one Sudoku puzzle every day, or maybe one Kakuro, some puzzle, small puzzles every day, it helps, makes you think, makes you better, and that will maybe improve your chances. Okay. How to spend time? Pick up some calculation sheets and solve. There are a lot of calculation sheets. Even I give calculation sheets to students. Just calculate, take a few calculations and solve. Some multiplication, some addition, some subtraction could help. Right? Try doing that. Apart from that, if possible, form study group becomes helps as such. And remember, I had a student, I think it was Rishabh's student also, and my student also. We have normally some common students. Yeah, I think I remember a student who from Nagpur itself. So therefore he was Rishabh's student also. And then he had come to Bombay. So then he was my student. So I remember that he just before the CAT examination, he had given a mock and he had scored minimum score. He said that was the minimum score I scored in that whole season from whatever mocks. So, but he said, lucky I had a friend whom I could talk to after the mocks. Just before the CAT, 3 days before the CAT, you're writing a mock. You say, this is my last mock. I'll not write a mock after that. And then you score a minimum marks. And luckily, he said, I had a friend whom I could talk to. So that relaxed me. So I didn't write a mock after that. Also, I had a friend whom he could talk to every time whenever he had a problem and discuss things. He ended up scoring a 99.92% in the actual CAT, which is like amazing. And managed to get into C because of the CAT, he didn't get into A, but he got into IMC. But yes, so from anywhere, having a friend always helps in the CAT because there's a lot of time when you get demotivated, you get down and you don't feel, as well. Then you need someone to talk. Also, maybe you discuss questions, discuss friends, it always helps.
Which student are we talking about? Tejal or Niket?
Tejal is a friendly. No, Tejal also went to IMC, but right, there was one more person who went. Nishit, I think. I will tell you name that. Nandish. I don't know where you know.
Oh, okay. Nandish.
Yeah. So, okay. So, once that is done, okay. We'll last end up with one more question and then we will find out. So start with the question, try to solve this question and then maybe we'll. Yeah, so what you could do here is normally start with a number. I normally prefer a number. So Dick is twice as old as Tom and Harry is twice as old as Dick. Now, if I knew what is Harry's age, I can make out it's a multiple of 6. Because if Tom is X, okay, Dick will be 3X and Harry will be 6X. It's a multiple of, but there's no option. So in that case, what I do is I'll start with a number and then do cross multiplication. So if I assume Tom as 1, Dick will be 3, Harry will be 6. Okay. So if you look at the total is 10. So average is 10 upon 3 10 upon 3 average. Whereas if Dick's age is 1 year less than the average age, but Dick's age is 3. So difference is how much? 1/3. When difference is 1/3, then Harry's age is 6. When difference age is 1, then Harry's age will be how much? 18. That'll be the answer. So I start with numbers. Again, here, assuming numbers and solving, and then cross multiplication. So start with Tom, Dick, and Harry as 1, 3, and 6. Again, if you want, you can do this orally. You don't even have to write this down. So Tom 1, Dick 3, Harry 6, equal 10 averages. 10 upon 3 or 3.33. So difference between Dick and the average is 1/3 or 0.3. At that time, the Harry's age is 6. To get a difference 1, then Harry's age will be how much? You'll get 18 as the answer. Cross multiplication. So cross multiplication, ratios, proportions, all these are very good ways of trying to solve things faster. Can I help and solve? Right. So with this, I finish my at least session in terms of talking. Yeah, Rushabh, what's the plan?